We're back. We have two matches left at Trusova Championships at an Insomnia 58 with me, Life Coach and Sotl. And the next match will be between our teammate, Radu from G2 Esports, and Fire from UK. And Sotl, you can tell us something more about Fire. He's a really young guy, right?
He is, yeah, and he's actually a former teammate of mine. First organization that I played for, Fire was a member of that team as well. And this was during a time where he was pretty committed to Hearthstone when he was, I think, 14, 15 years old back then. Mm-hmm. He was competing in a lot of online cups, as he will famously tell you if you give him a chance. He once beat Fire Bat, previous world champion, in the final of a Zotac Open. 3-0'd him with Zoo, I think I remember being the case back in last hero standing. So that's his crowning achievement. He likes to hold that up. But he took a bit of a break from playing the game seriously. I think he had school commitments or something. But he's back making a push again now, and obviously working out pretty well for him through the Swiss here, and now still in with a shot of top 8 tomorrow.
Seems like it. We can also take a look at the bracket. This is Group C. And you know what? This match already happened.
It did?
It did, because the first match for RDU and for Fire was actually between them. And the winner was Fire. If I'm not mistaken, it was a 3-2, and Radu was upset about it. But it's nothing new for us, right? He is a very emotional player. And yeah, now he has his chance for revenge. So what are your predictions, guys? Life Coach.
Yeah, I go for Radu, but I'm also biased, so maybe...
honestly, I think I'd probably favor Radu a little bit in this one as well. I think he came up to me before the first game and asked me if, like, you know, he's a UK player, do you know anything about what he might be playing? And I was like, honestly, like, even, you know, if I wasn't invested and, you know, wanted to give you as much help as I could, like, he's been out of the game for so long, he could be playing anything. Like, I really don't know what his trends are these days. So I think RDU went into that first game a bit blind. Mm-hmm. And now, you know, he's worked out what some of the decks are, and he can come up with a more robust, you know, pick and ban strategy. And I think that might just give him the edge this time around.
Yeah, that might be the case. It's also very, what he mentions is also actually very interesting. When you have a chance to regame, basically,
right,
against a player, right? If you had an unusual lineup, you can benefit from that because you have more information, you can adjust your bans, you can also, which is even more important than the ban, you can adjust your mulligans accordingly, right?
Yep.
Do you have the same opinion, Lefkot?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Radu had now also the opportunity to scout the game against Chucky. Mm-hmm. And I guess you got some revelation there. Games went longer, and he could definitely scout a lot. So I'm pretty sure that Radu is very confident of the knowledge of the decks of his opponent and will adjust accordingly, for sure.
Yeah, and, well, we can't really also not talk about the fact that his Fire is like 17 years old
something
right
like
now.
Yeah.
Probably one of his first appearances on stage as well, right? This is taking some toll on players as well. I mean, for now we're kind of accustomed to it, that most of the players are, like, you know, playing on stage in front of thousands of people. Usual stuff. Happens every weekend,
yep,
right? But not for everyone. Some people are just newcomers to the stage, newcomers to the competitive Hearthstone environment, and playing on stage in front of thousands of people might be actually, you know, making them nervous.
And Fire's had it so that on the other side, he's had a very accomplished, confident opponent on the other side both times. He's got RDU this time. Last game was Chucky on the main stage. So those are players who aren't going to feel it as much. So he's definitely had, like, the detriment on that. But I want to ask you guys a question, actually, like, knowing RDU a little bit better. Like, as you said, he was quite emotional after the loss originally. And I think from what I know of Fire, he's the kind of character that maybe might try and play on that a little bit and, like, keep winding him up during the course of this game. Like, do you think RDU can overcome that and play properly? Is he easy to tilt, like, actually to the point of making him play worse? Or, like, where does he stand?
I would say RDU is one of the guys that can be prone to tilt. Like, someone can actually work the nerves on him, you know? Pin the needle into his back and just watch him scrim, you know? So, like, some form of BM, I don't know, roping for no apparent reason, right? Those can be the tools that Fire can use against RDU.
Maybe if he would play Sogoth the Slitherer and Radu could do nothing about it, for example.
Well, this is PTSD again for me from Seed Story Cup when I lost with my OTK Warrior against Sogoth.
Ooh, feels bad. Yeah, I don't think that's a card that OTK Warrior is going to beat too often.
That's true. Anyway, Group C will start soon, but we still have to fill some time. Never mind. We're going to the versus now. So.
Fantastic! Couldn't have timed it better.
Yeah, great timing. RDU just left.
So, interesting. So yeah, RDU chose to ban Warrior in their first matchup. I know that as well. So he stayed consistent with his ban. He's banned Warrior again. I think Fire had the most success in the first series with his Freeze Mage. He went 2-0 with Freeze Mage.
Interesting.
And then like you know, RDU fought back a little bit, and Fire picked up the 3-2 in the last game. So I would imagine the predictable line here is that Fire would lead out with Freeze Mage again, and so you know, if RDU's reading that, he might try and queue up his best deck against it. But then of course there's the next level of like, I did that this last time, so am I going to do it again? So I think like the first mind games of the first pick order is going to go a long way in this.
Which is a very
isn't it nice, by the way, to be actually able to talk about pick order in a format? Yeah. Isn't that just lovely?
Yeah, it's great.
That is lovely. And we actually made some research like back then, that usually players are sticking to the choice, right?
Yes.
So an example, Oskaka, both time on stage, he did pick Freeze Mage as the first deck, right?
Right.
And not a lot of players actually changed their strategy. Mm-hmm. That's the thing. So sometimes you can take advantage of it, but as you said, sometimes they can just switch and outplay you in the first pick, right?
Yeah.
I would say that RDU will never pick his Zoo in the opening game, right? Because of that. Because he can always pick his Druid, which would be a safe choice against Freeze Mage and Auto decks.
Agreed.
While Zoo would be horrible against Freeze Mage, while still decent against Auto ones.
Yeah. There's very little upside to picking Zoo first, right? Yep. Like, it's not like a role you can win. Whereas, you know, you want to target something at the Freeze Mage, but like you said, the Zoo is better reserved for later on as a counter pick to something else.
Although, from what I know, RDU is playing Alchemists in his deck. So this is another weapon against Doomsayers, but still doesn't guarantee anything.
It gives you a few extra percentage points on the win rate, I think, but you're still like Zoo against Freeze Mage is bad. A starting point. If you add Crazed Alchemist in there, sure, you can sneak out a couple of wins here and there, but overall percentage it doesn't increase that much just to have them in your deck. You disagree?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
It can do a lot. But
okay.
I mean, I agree that the matchup is probably still negative.
Right, sure.
I guess one Alchemist might add 5%.
Okay.
Maybe a little bit more even.
Yeah, I wouldn't dispute that much. I'm just saying like it's not going to swing, you know, what is a bad matchup to a favorite.
I definitely agree there. Yeah, that's true.
And a lot of Freeze Mages actually are not playing Flame Strikes anymore, right?
Mm-hmm.
What's the case with that?
I don't think Flame Strike is as good against Zoo as a lot of people seem to think it is. It's just a little bit slow. Like a lot of the time when you get to that point in the game, you'd rather just freeze the board plus do something else a lot of the time, instead of just spending a whole turn on Flame Strike. So I don't actually think it's a big deal not to be running Flame Strike.
Okay, it's an interesting opinion. But we start, look
with
at that.
Wow.
With a Flame Strike, a Freeze Mage, but also with a Zoo.
Oh, sick.
So yeah, my prediction, your prediction, guys, were like kind of.
What do we know? We just didn't.
Yeah,
right?
We didn't hit it. But anyway, guys, please take it away. This is the second to the last match of the day between RDU and Fire.
Thank you very much. So, Life Coach, has RDU just outthought himself here? Is it just like there's no way he's going to lead Freeze Mage again, the idea? What happened?
I'm also not that sure about it. I mean, as we just also discussed, a Zoo first pick might be not ideal.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see how it goes.
We're gonna see how it goes. Like I said, I think this first matchup is a really big deal, and Fire definitely seems like he's got the better of the exchange so far. Decent opening hand as well. All the cycle cards. He has the choice of the three main cycle tools in the deck, and just gonna go ahead and coin out the Loot Hoarder to contest it.
Well, he's just super mega insane, the Loot Hoarder here, right?
Yeah.
I mean, what the heck? It's with follow up, with nice follow ups. Maybe turn 5, Doomsayer into Frost Nova. Mm-hmm. I mean, if that happens, it's probably already over.
Well, he did just pick up the Alchemist, so the Doomsayer isn't a complete lockout now, and we will get to see exactly how much of an impact that Alchemist makes, but I'm just going to go ahead with the Peddler for now, and not the most attractive of options. Honestly, I think it might be Stone Tusk Ball.
Yeah, of course, more control.
There you go. It's just... So, like damage from hand against Freeze Mage is just important, right? Even if it's as small as a Stone Tusk Boar, you can get into situations where, you know, they can freeze your board, they can freeze your face if you're a melee class that wants to attack, but they can't stop you dropping cards from hand to continue damage. So Loot Hoarder going to train in and trade in. Cycles into the Acolyte. This is such a good opening for the Freeze Mage now. All the cycle tools he could possibly want.
Do you think that he even got maybe a little bit too many of those?
It's possible. I mean, The loot hoarder, as you said, was glorious on the first.
Oh, map, yeah.
Yeah,
oh,
now, yeah. Now novice engineer, not looking quite so spectacular, but still, you'd rather have too much cycle than no cycle in your opening hand, I guess. So I think Fire will be happy to like err on this side of it.
I mean, it just gets tricky if he doesn't have enough time to play all of those.
Sure.
And at the moment, we're at 9 mana. So that's at 9 mana to play all of those. So that's pretty expensive.
It is, yeah. I think, you know, one of the Arcane Intellects might just come in as like a last gasp thing. Like when the game's, you know, reached the critical point where, you know, Freeze Mage has passed what TJ with this last weekend was just calling the turn, where, like, right. You know, board control is now over. It's just I have enough turns to kill you. You know, at that point, the last Arcane Intellect might be really useful just to power through.
Right, right. And the Acolyte is also so pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, he forces basically the damage on the Acolyte. And if Radu wouldn't have had the Abusive Sergeant, it would have been even way, way worse, because then he might have been required to play Power Whelming even.
Sure. In this situation, he might have even had a serious think about using the Crazed Alchemist just to deny a card draw, right? He could have flipped the Acolyte and traded in, but does have the Abusive Sergeant, so no issues. We'll be able to just deny the card draw.
Yeah, it's also way too important for the Doomsayer.
Yeah, I agree. You need the Crazed Alchemist. Yeah, so Abusive is for sure going to come down this turn. He's just making sure he gets all his positional concerns correct and whether he wants to trade for value with the 2-2, as you see, or just trade in one of the 1-1s just to keep a little bit of extra health on his 2-1.
I mean, it's pretty good for the Freeze Mage. He can do what we talked about, the Doomsayer, Frost Nova stuff. But even, I mean, we know that this won't succeed, but it's directly followed by a Blizzard, and that's right. Just super huge.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. So we may honestly just see another Acolyte come down here and say, you know, you had one buff, do you have another one here? But Fire looks like he's going for the Arcane Intellect instead, which is fine. It will just fill him up to 9 cards, so plenty of room in his hand. And I guess he's going to save the Acolyte for the turn after, in his mind, the Doomsayer goes off, just so he has some sort of board presence to develop.
Mm. But I'm not sure. It's a little bit inconsistent, his line, right? Because first he chose to play Acolyte over the draw 2 cards, mm-hmm. and then after the buff already went out of the deck, he now suddenly chooses to draw the 2 cards.
Sure. Yeah, no, I agree with you. It feels like, you know, they've used one buff and it wasn't a clean turn either. You know, it was a tap and then kind of awkward usage of 2 1 mana cards. So it feels like he didn't have the perfect answer that he wanted that turn. You know, Direwolf probably would have been played there just for mana efficiency instead of the Abusive. So it felt like a good time to try and get 2 cards from the Acolyte, but Fire just goes ahead with the Arcane, and he's going to be hoping this Frost Nova Doomsayer does work next turn, but that Crazed Alchemist is going to have a say on this game for sure.
So at the moment, he still haven't played 2 of his card draw options. He might be a little bit too slow for them. On the other hand, we also see in Rado's hand a double Doomguard, mm-hmm. and that's kind of a bad beat, because having really both of them in their hand is so bad.
Yeah, and you see RDU is tapping every single turn here, which is usually a dangerous game against Freeze Mage, because you don't want to lower yourself that much, but he's kind of obligated to, because one, he can't just go ahead and flood the board here, because he needs to make sure he has room in play for the Crazed Alchemist to come down. Mm-hmm. And two, he wants to fill up his hand enough so that maybe at some point he can play both of those Doom Guards over the course of the game to actually push through damage. So he's forcing to kind of play into the Freeze Mage's hands here and actually lower himself into burn range. And Fire will, of course, consider his options this turn. But this is Frost Nova Doomsayer, 100%.
100%, yeah. I agree.
So he is just going to assess all the possible options. Even a cycle turn here just has no appeal, because you're going to get yourself into a 10-card hand situation very, very quickly. So you need to dump some cards from your hand. No real better way to do that than the Frost Nova Doomsayer here.
And you also cannot go greedy with a with the armor and such things, because it's way too dangerous.
Sure.
You want the armor way later.
Yeah, agreed. So the Alchemist is going to come down here, but it will be the entire turn. Siege Ivy would have loved to have played, but there's just not the room.
Which is pretty insane, because that makes such a big difference here.
Yeah, it's huge. And remember, there was the decision early on from RDU about whether to value trade with that 2-1 that's still alive, or whether to trade with a fresh 1-1. You see that 2-1 still on the board, so if he'd have traded the other way around, he would have the Sea Giant turn this turn.
Exactly. damage-wise, it was the same now, right? Because he first lost one damage, and now now he delivered one more damage.
Yeah, I think so. Mm-hmm. I think that's right, yeah. So Alchemist is going to come down. This will be the entire turn, though, and we'll see. It looks like RDU is bypassing tapping as well now. Doesn't want to put himself down to 21.
Interesting.
And as you said, sure, I know he took his shot with the Frost Nova Doomsayer. It didn't go off, but no big deal, really, because he just has that...
Wait, what?
Whoa. Fire, slow down. Wow. There's no way. You're just going to die. I cannot go.
I mean, it is a fireball.
Sure. Yeah, this has to be a Blizzard turn. I mean, he is pretty close in his hand at just being able to burn out from here, but you are just going to die if you start going aggressive from here.
Yeah, and this is also very convenient. I mean, Rado really did. I also really didn't like not to tap again, but I mean, we are probably on the more greedier side as it seems.
Sure.
We always want to tap it.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. I just felt like. You know, some, you know, maybe a lot of the time, like Reno Lock against Freeze Mage, if you already have, say, Reno in hand and some tools, then, you know, tapping can sometimes be a little bit pointless. But this is a bad matchup anyway, so you're going to have to kind of take the risks, which, you know, in this case involves trying to play those two Doom Guards, probably, which means tapping a lot to make sure you have a big hand.
Exactly. Absolutely agree.
Oh!
Man. And this is exactly the thing, right? So. One more card means way less discard potential to discard this Doomguard. And I agree with you, Sotil, that the double Doomguard is probably the only way to close this down in favor for the zoo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so there's a little bit of an overlap in the hand. I think that card concealed behind the fireball is a second Forgotten Torch. So he actually has 6, 9, 13, 19 damage plus 2 pings. So he has 21 over 2 turns here, but he can't just go because there's no ice block been developed. There's loads of damage on the board, so he does have to try and find one of those kind of hybrid Freeze Mage plays where you stall yourself a turn but still start to like achieve something aggressive at the same time.
I mean, you could try to make the Doomsayer happen with maybe one freeze, with one Ice Lance. Maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe even a Frostbolt, I don't know. But freezing the Doomguard and... Well, even torching the wolf, maybe? I don't know. I mean, the thing is that Fire knows that there is no Doomguard, right? So even a power ramming, or even like this. Like this he's safe before a power over...
No. Well,
not against a boar and a power overwhelming.
Right.
But, I mean, he can assume that he's safe because he saw the second Doomguard going out of the deck, right?
Yeah. But, you know, crucially, this is not a very aggressive turn from RDU here. He is able to clear out the Doomsayer and maintain his Doomguard, but this might be just the little breathing space that Fire needs. So, you know, this turn he can set up the Ice Barrier for a bit of protection, potentially, you know, Frostbolt the Doomguard again if he wants to be ultra defensive, and then he can really start looking forward to just a straight burning phase plan.
Exactly. It was also pretty close, right? It was only one of lethal, I mean.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, it's, yeah, one off. It's so close. I wouldn't have assumed that it would go so close, or that it would be so close at any point of this
right.
game.
Yeah, I mean, Fire just hasn't been able to draw an ice block yet, which is the biggest deal, because he'd like that is just the ultimate guaranteed one turn of security for Freeze Mage. So he's gonna have to be a little bit cuter here in terms of manipulating the ice barrier to keep him alive while he gets through his necessary number of turns. So. Sure, we'll see the barrier come down this turn, and I think you have to Frostbolt the Doomguard again to try and protect the barrier, or try and protect your total life, right?
I really would have liked to torch the wolf last turn, because then you would have also prevented the second wolf and the power whamming, which would have also cleared the Doomsayer. I mean, how the situation has been, it was probably that Fire simply wins immediately when the Doomsayer goes off, or what do you think, Sotil?
If the Doomsayer goes off, I think the game is absolutely over, yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
I mean, especially with the draw, he could have just jammed Emperor on an empty board this turn. That would have been pretty much game. But actually, looking at his line here, I like the aggressive line he's taken, because he just saw Power Overwhelming number one used, and he's seen both Doomguards, one used, one discarded. Yep. So actually, he's pretty chill at 9. He can sit back here and take his free turn.
Oh, yeah, I definitely like this run. Mm-hmm. I just meant... that he might have been more inclined to force out the Doomsayer, but I
right,
guess,
right,
yeah.
With the Torch and the Ice Lance on the previous turn?
Yeah,
yeah,
exactly.
Right, I understand. But yeah, now Acolyte coming in for huge value. If he picked up the Alexstrasza as well, which can give him some auto kills if he does get up the ice block, but still just sitting on that ice barrier for now. Frost Nova
is a huge deal,
though. Now the question is, do we need Emperor to come down, or do we take this free turn to set up some defenses with Ice Barrier? I think I like Emperor a little bit more.
Yeah, I like it very much. I mean, I'm also just wondering whether you could have also not, let's say, assuming you would have not drawn this card, you might have even changed the gears to take a defensive stand suddenly.
Sure. Yeah, I totally see that.
Because you can clear, you could have cleared the Doomguard, then there's only 5 damage on the board, or maybe
right.
6 damage. You can Alexstrasza yourself maybe at some point after you clear some stuff. But yeah, obviously this is pretty good.
Oh yeah, this is the old fabled 2 turns of Emperor and Freeze Mage, which generally does not end too well for the opponent. So Radu is drastically considering all his options here. I mean, most people this far into Hearthstone have their Freeze Mage maths down pretty solid in terms of what combinations do how much damage. When Emperor comes into play, though, suddenly it gets a lot more complicated. Forgotten Torch changed the maths a lot as well, because suddenly there was a 3 mana fireball that can then get discounted to 2. So, you know, mana combinations with or without Blood Mage, with or without Emperor, like, knowing every single combination that can happen to you is It's pretty high-level stuff at the very top end of the game.
Well, I guess if you're Zoo and you are at 19 life, Thorsten just came down, I guess you just don't play around anything
anymore. I agree. Yeah, I completely agree with you. Dark Peddler is going to come down, picks up the Reliquary Seeker, not bad. Generates himself a 5-5, but of course no answer to the Emperor. Frostbolt picked up, but still no Ice Block. So he can't set up the guaranteed kill here, but he has pretty much all the tools he's going to need, especially since he can cycle more cards off this Acolyte of Pain immediately.
Yeah, I guess the offensive Alex is really also not needed anymore, so
right.
He can really basically bring himself up to 23 life here with Alexstrasza and the Ice Barrier if he wants.
That's true. And he
trade.
Would take, yeah, he would only take 1 power off the board through trading. Whether he killed the 1-1 or the 2-3, it only takes 1 power off. So there's that Flame Strike, though, which is it good enough here? So he can Flame Strike. There will be a 1-1 left on the board. He can trade for the 5-5. So it would need to be Power Overwhelming plus something to get the job done. So yeah, this Flame Strike is a very, very big deal. Fire gonna shut his eyes here and just hope. Forbidden Ritual, not the card RDU's looking for. Hey, you have to. I mean, RDU's gonna think again. There's no one card that gives him lethal now, right? So.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I definitely agree with this line. I mean, he already saw so many POs going on, Doomguards going both out of the deck, so
yeah,
it should be safe.
No, but just from RDU's perspective, like this time I can kind of understand his consideration as to whether or not he taps, because there is no one card that
you can pick up, right?
So in this case, the thing that we talked about in the previous series, which is the idea of I'm probably only going to tap one more time this game, and I can make that next turn, in this case it actually makes sense.
Okay, yeah, definitely agree there. Mm-hmm.
But that ice block being picked up means the game is over. He has enough damage spread over 2 turns. The board is full, so even if there was any weird trick, like somehow Lotheb got reprinted into the game, like he couldn't even play it. So that is just going to be game one for Fire here, as long as he works out a reasonable, logical way of playing these cards, which I'm sure he will.
Where did Lotheb come from?
I don't know. So yeah, he's just going to work out exactly what he needs to play here. Just play it ultra safe with the Ice Barrier as well. Why not? He can play his remaining damage in the following turn, no problem. So a little shake of the head from Fire. He knows this game was a little bit more stressful than maybe it could have been if he'd got an earlier Ice Block, but he got there in the end. And yeah, Radu just going to give it up. And this is the point where that frustration thing comes in. Like, is RDU going to get tilted again in this game? Because I saw him walking away from his first game against Fire, and he was not a happy boy. He charged backstage with a scowl on his face. And yeah, so I think Fire did get under his skin a little bit in the first game. But if anyone's looking a bit emotional so far, it's Fire. He looks a little bit nervous sat there, if you ask me.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, he does.
But yeah, the Freeze Mage is going to queue up again. And like I said, Freeze Mage in the first series was the big standout for Four Fire. Mm-hmm. And I think that the best deck that RDU has against Freeze Mage is Yogg-Druid. Like, how do you feel about that matchup? Because I've heard some different things from different people.
I guess he's just taking the Warrior. That's probably the best.
Oh, sorry, I thought he banned Warrior. Shaman. Rara, you're right. Yeah. I thought the Warrior was banned, but the Shaman's banned. You're completely right. But this is Combo Warrior, as you can see, which normally doesn't even run Armorsmith. So This is an offensive matchup, I would assume, from the Warrior's side. Or can they actually out-armor the Freeze Mage damage?
Well, they cannot completely out-armor the Freeze Mage damage, but they do run double shield block.
Okay.
And they do run, obviously the hero power. So,
yep.
Usually the damage just don't run that the life total is addressed in the first X turns. And after Lextrasa comes down, usually Freeze Mage has the potential to deliver these 15 damage, but Freeze Mage doesn't have the potential to deliver these 25 damage, at least not until their deck is very, very deep, until they are very deep in their deck. And I guess that's a very big threshold, because if you can just prevent that Freeze Mage rushes you down with Lextrasa into turn 10 kill, you have so much time to deliver so many problems against for the Freeze Mage that usually that should be enough.
Okay. Yeah, it makes sense. I remember, like, even way back in the day with Warsong Patron Warrior, the original form, there was always a debate about whether you were supposed to be aggressive against Freeze Mage or just wait for double Armorsmith and then, you know, gain a million armor. So it's really interesting to see how, you know, the builds of Warrior that, you know, can't just gain 20 with Bran Ancient Shieldbearer, where the decision's obvious. Like, it's how am I supposed to play against Freeze Mage? Do I try and pressure them, which is what every other deck has to do, or you know, does my exclusive Warrior ability give me the chance to just outlast all the damage?
But it's also a very big point that there are now two Arcane Giants in this Warrior deck. And these basically prevent you losing the complete utter board control. The giant is perfectly enough to create the board presence you need to force out freezes, and that's the important part of it.
Yeah, that definitely makes sense. As long as you, I guess, like, a big part of the exchange is like trying to engineer a situation where you don't get your giant caught in a Frost Nova Doomsayer play. You know, sure that you have an execute on hand or some way to deal with the Doomsayer, because previous builds of Freeze Mage used to play the extra threats like Archmage Antonidas,
right.
So Warriors would have to, you know, earmark one execute for Alexstrasza, one for Archmage Antonidas, try and do like slam Fiery War Axe on Emperor or something like that. But now the Freeze Mage deck is a lot more lean and a lot more streamlined, I guess. Yeah. So those big threats aren't really there. So I think you can get away with execute on a Doomsayer a lot more often in this matchup now.
Exactly. It's also interesting that Fire decides to already ping the face instead of the minion.
Yep.
I guess that's because he plans to set up for a nice Frost Nova Doomsayer turn, and he says it doesn't matter anyways. But I'm not sure. What do you think, Sultan?
Well, there's no armor on the Warrior now, right?
Yeah, so exactly.
Like, pinging the health is usually pretty unimportant. I can understand pinging armor at all times. I'd be perfectly okay with that, but you're almost always going to try and win this game with an offensive Alexstrasza line, in my opinion.
Yep.
So the ping to the health seems to just be purely wasted damage most of the time.
Yeah, I also think so.
So is it Frost Nova Doomsayer turn already? I mean, he's missed pretty much all of his cycle this time after hitting it in the previous series. So it looks like Fire is just going to chill for now, and this time with armor on the Warrior decides to ping the minion.
Yeah.
So seems to have got this a little bit backwards from Fire.
Yeah, I also don't know completely.
Coin going to come out. It's just going to be Coin Emperor here. The reason for Fire's ping last turn, from his perspective, of course, he's trying to set up a blizzard by pinging the minion down to 3-2. But
right.
It's still slightly inconsistent with what he was doing the turn before. And it looks like he is just going to commit to that Blizzard, and the Emperor is going to get two turns of value immediately in the Combo Warrior deck, which is going to be potentially devastating.
Yeah, I agree partly there, because the Combo Warrior, I mean, at least this Combo Warrior is not like the Wong Warrior, who really tries to squeeze any amount of discount, but it's really that you need one turn of discount, and afterwards you are usually able to play all of your cards in your hand anyways.
Sure.
So I think, I mean, it hurts definitely to leave it up, but not as much as it might seem.
So, slam on the Acolyte. He's going to try and absolutely max out on his card draw here. Could he use Blood to Ichor for just the one draw, but he's going to slam for two instead, just to maximize his amount of Emperor discounts, because I think RDU knows that Emperor isn't going to live another turn, so he might as well get the maximum card draw through now.
Yeah, absolutely. And in this case, he was also, by the way, right, in this case, he really profits and benefits a lot from this Emperor discount, but it's from Fire's perspective that didn't necessarily need to be the case.
Okay. So he has options here. He has to definitely find some way of dealing with this 5-3. Nonetheless, because it's Emperor, but also he just can't afford to have that thing attacking every turn. You know, he needs to get rid of it from the board. And Flame Strike is, of course, one of his highest priority cards in this yep. deck. He knows he's played this lineup before. He knows he's expecting patrons. He knows what the deal is. So he'll know that his Frost Nova Doomsayers and his Blood Mage plus Blizzard combinations are just like really key tools. So we're probably just going to end up seeing a clean Frostbolt or Forgotten Torch, most likely the Torch coming down on the Emperor.
Mm-hmm.
And goes ahead and pings out the Acolyte, and not much consideration here. You could consider a Tempo Doomsayer, but it seems pretty ridiculous when you have two Frost Novas in your hand already. So,
well, the thing is, if you would have played the Tempo Doomsayer, you would have probably left the Acolyte on board, right?
Sure. Yeah, that makes sense as well. Just not a lot going on in RDU's hand right now. He's just going to generate another Acolyte on the board. Those Arcane Giants are getting to the point where they're playable, though.
So this time Blood to Ichor, not the Slam.
Mm-hmm. And again, the difference from the previous turn being last turn, cycling cards was just so overvalued because the Emperor was on board. So.
Definitely. Definitely going for the better rage here.
Oh, yeah.
Just so good.
I mean, RDU is, I think, a little bit unhappy about spending a turn where he doesn't press the armor button, but it's just a great... That battle rage just fits so nicely into his curve, right?
Yeah.
He might be really looking good and thinking, like, with the zero mana Pyromancer in his hand already, he's never going to have a problem playing battle rage, right? He can always get it done. So I think that's probably what's ended up convincing him that the armor is better.
No, I think it's very close. It might also be that the armor is better. I mean, it's just close.
I mean, it's not a scary board, but I think I just like Frost Nova Doomsayer here just to give yourself an empty board Alex on the following turn.
I also like it very much. And you also undermine the Carter from the Acolyte as well as the byproduct. That's really good.
Yeah, I think Fire's just trying to work out what to do with the rest of his mana here. It does have the Ice Barrier pickup, which is perfect to go along with it. And yeah, looks like he sees the line. He's going to go for this this turn 9 empty board Alexstrasza, but RDU has all the tools to deny it.
Oh, yeah. So Fiery, then Execute, then Giant. Super good. Super strong.
Yeah. Can fit in Slams in there if he wants to. He can fit in Pyromancer Battle Rage in there if he wants to. He can do all kinds of things this turn. So he can pretty much pick his poison. Those Arcane Giants take a little bit of getting used to as to... Sometimes you, at the start of a turn, you don't quite realize how much else you can do first before you end up playing a giant. But when you get the feel for it, you start to realize exactly how powerful those things are.
But, he doesn't do it.
Doesn't. He's actually not going to execute the Doomsayer, despite having both executes in hand now as well. He chooses to allow the initiative to pass back to Fire, and I'm sure we are going to see.
That's really, really surprising to me that he didn't opt in for the Slam into execute into Giant, because it means he preserves his entire board, he preserves a Catra, and he also puts off on a lot of pressure on the board, putting the Freeze Mage on a very dangerous clock.
Yeah, I completely agree. We've been calling this Combo Warrior, and I knew RDU was playing a Patron Arcane Giants variant, but I haven't seen, for example, Charge and or Faceless Manipulator or anything like that drawn, so I don't know if there's the burst damage from hand to come out and really pop the block from hand. There is a Grommash, which makes me suspect that it's just a pure, board control patrons with Grommash as a finisher, but still, that Grom might be a big deal in terms of dealing the final push from hand.
Oh, no, sure, yeah. This kind of warrior doesn't run any kind of charges, so no Faceless Manipulator, no charge.
Okay. So I've seen builds of this deck being played where it's same kind of shell, but they copy the little thing from the Worgen, I guess, where it's just they charge the zero mana Arcane Giants at your face at the end of it. So I personally like this build that RDU is running a lot more, just the more consistent patron mid range version. But Ice Block going to come down now, which is decent protection against the Giants. Can lock them out as well with the second Frost Nova, but still, as you said, without really any spectacular armor gain tools, the Warrior has been able to get up 18 armor, which is just such a huge buffer in terms of forcing fire to burst through it here.
Exactly. I mean, the Freeze Mage has access to 15 would have not been a problem. 20, same thing, but more than 20, just so difficult without drawing the entirety of your deck.
Right.
And you just run out of time. The Giants, they attack once, they probably attack a second time, and then it's just over.
Yeah, so fire is effective 26 now with an ice block up, but those two A8s will chew through that very, very quickly indeed. And RDU still has gas to back it up with the Grommash, and he's just going to go ahead and activate it right away and force through some damage. I guess with the one remaining execute in hand, he knows that the only thing this board is weak to is another Frost Nova Doomsayer, and he can deal with that perfectly comfortably with the hat that he has. So. Cloak coming out. Is Fire going to see what he picks up? Blizzard?
But just a little bit short.
Yeah, just a little bit too expensive. So Fire is going to commit the Fireball here, but I don't see this going down an avenue that wins him the game.
What do you think in terms of value? Probably not. I mean, I was thinking that you might be able to address some of the minions and running the Warrior out of value, but I don't think it will happen.
Yeah, especially since you do have the Flamestrike in your hand, but you haven't seen any patrons come out yet, for example. Yeah. So there's still so many refills left in the deck, and even after that, you're going to fatigue at roughly the same pace. The Warrior deck cycles very hard, but so do you. So even if it comes down to fatigue, if you're starting that fatigue battle at 1 or 2 health and they're starting it at 30 something, and it's still not going to come out in your favor.
Yeah, definitely agree.
So Novice comes down, just picking up more cycle. This is all the stuff you would have wanted in the early game. Like you said, this is a matchup where it is really important to just draw your whole deck extremely quickly, and picking up all the cycle just a little bit too late means that Fire is going to give it up. RDU has vanquished the deck that gave him the most trouble in the previous series, the Freeze Mage. He's back on level footing now, and RDU has to pick into his combo warrior with his Yogg Druid, and what's his third deck? I can't quite remember off the top of my head. His warrior was banned. I think his last deck is Zoo, if I remember correctly. So Yogg Druid and or Zoo up against the Patron Warrior. I don't think you're picking Zoo into it anytime soon, right? Mm-hmm. So looks like it's going to be a Yogg Druid pick from Fire, most likely.
But Zoo has 30% against this Warrior deck, so it's like really...
Oh, no, that's right. It's Nazoth Paladin, I remember. Yeah, this makes sense. My mistake. It's the Nazoth Paladin deck. So this, much, much bigger chance. It has, some decent answers in the form of, the equality clears, one of the few things that can interact with a huge board of patrons favorably. Yeah. And if there's no burst damage from the Giants, as we were talking about before, then, just an 8-8 plopped on the board is not really a huge deal to a Paladin. They can neutralize it in such a variety of ways. So. It should be a pretty reasonable matchup for Fire overall.
Oh, definitely, yeah. I mean, the Paladin has all the tools, basically what you just mentioned. The Warrior will have to gamble at some point of the game. 4 patrons, usually not enough pressure, so maybe even producing 5, maybe 6, and then just probably running into this equality board clear, and then maybe looking a little bit dumb, but I guess that's what he has to do.
Right. I think so. When Nazoth Paladin first came out, and mid-range patron was being played a little bit at that time, but that deck you could kind of threat check Nazoth Paladin over and over again. You could play like turn 3 Frothing Berserker. Do you have the True Silver for this? If not, you're under a lot of pressure, and you could keep doing that throughout the game. But this version of the deck can't play that curve of threats, right? There's no Frothing Berserker, there's no Bloodhoof Brave. It's just all in on the combo plan, and that just takes a little bit longer to set up, and then you give so much time for the Nazoth Paladin to pick up the pieces they need.
Exactly. It's basically that both decks are reactive in the first 5-6 turns of the game.
Yeah.
But once they become active themselves, well, the Nazoth Paladin is simply stronger.
I agree. What do you think of it seems a simple decision, but pressing Hero Power as Paladin on turn 2 against an Acolyte of Pain deck?
Yeah.
Is it ever something that you consider skipping when you know that the Acolyte is a potential follow-up?
Interesting question. Maybe.
I think so. If you have Coin True Silver, then no worries at all, right? Because you can always just Coin True Silver the Acolyte. But I've seen this situation so often against, you know, Freeze Mages, Combo Warriors, all this kind of thing, where turn two hero power, they drop the Acolyte, and you're just immediately in trouble. And sure, Fire had the Doomsayer to come down here, but the Acolyte was still able to cycle one card first. So.
Absolutely.
I mean, how much does that 1-1 actually do for you in the long term to be worth the potential downside of facing up to the Acolyte?
Exactly. But he doesn't learn.
He just messes it again.
Acolyte again.
Still no Kodo in hand either. So, I mean, this RDU might choose to give this play some respect. He might say, well, no, he wouldn't do this again unless he had the Kodo.
Right. But I guess it's fine. After you saw the first Acolyte, of course, you produce a 1-1. Sure.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think this is understandable. But I genuinely think RDU is considering that there must be a Stampede in Kodo, right? If he just keeps pressing that button. I'm really interested as whether we see the Acolyte here. He is going to bring it out. And again, Fire just has no answer.
I mean, there were not that many options. And even if Rado would be afraid of a Kodo, then he could simply play, this. Yeah.
Exactly.
Exactly.
So immediate two-card cycle off the Acolyte, picks up the Battle Rage as well, so he's already digging through his deck quite nicely. Fire does have a clean Patron Clear available to him already, but just this state of the minions on board is slightly irritating right now, but unless he wants to commit a Pyro, he's kind of just stuck with the Coin Ivory Knight play. Looks like the only solid option right now.
Well, I also really like it because Rado has kind of a problem that he may not play any spell now.
Mm-hmm.
Unless he sacrificed the Pyromancer anyways, but that's also a bad trade on the 4-4 horse.
Yep. I like it. Not the best option, so probably just try and like rebuy with Light in the Darkness, basically. Just, you know, get another Discover effect to try and get like a high quality card out of it.
Yep.
Noble Sack and Blessing of Might, probably not going to be the tools you need. There's a little bit of merit to having a one mana spell with Pyromancer in your hand, but I think overall Light in the Darkness is just probably the best option here.
Yeah, it's probably what you say. I mean, a Light in the Darkness, I don't like the card, but I like the two other cards even less.
Yeah, it seems weird to just, like, you know, just raw value, just value Discover, essentially, at two mana. Like, yeah, you get the +1/+1, but, like, it just seems a bit overcosted to just Discover a minion for two mana.
Yeah, it definitely is. I mean, one interesting thing is also that Rado could have also not sacrificed the Pyromancer and then play a Whirlwind or something, because that would have also eaten his own 3-1. So the 4-4 really aligns very nicely on the board here.
Yeah, that's very true. RDU here, he can actually, well, he's not injured himself, which is the problem. So, cards like Battle Rage are a bit less appealing. So he's just going to consider his options here. Commanding Shout potentially can be played to maintain the Pyromancer on board, and it looks like that is what he's going to go for. A little bit surprising because it is an extremely high value card in your deck just for pairing things like Battle Rage, but Raddy's just going to go ahead and cycle one off the Battle Rage here, which surprises me a little bit as well, but I guess he's reached the point of the game now where he thinks he's not going to injure himself anytime soon, so he just commits to it. Just some of these weird Commanding Shout interactions going off. You can slam a one health minion and still draw a card.
Savannah seemed to be fine, yeah. I mean, you could also play the Ivory. No, you cannot. 2, 4, 6, 8, 9, yeah, you could, yeah. Yeah. I would.
I think the Sylvanas just seems a little bit low value here. I mean, you do want to just get it played at some point, right? Because you want it out the way before you eventually Nuzzoth. But that doesn't mean you should stop trying to like get good value from the Sylvanas. And I think Ivory Knight ends up doing pretty much the same job here a lot of the time.
Yeah, I also think so. I mean, the Sylvanas simply dies, right? For nothing. So why should you do it?
Oh, and again. Oh, okay, Aslan. I thought that was another secret on the left-hand side then. I was like,
no, that's fine. He doesn't get the full value from the heal, though, but whatever. Who cares?
There's also merit to this as well, because when you don't get full value from the heal, you actually conceal the information from your opponent about what cards you've picked.
Okay.
Because the America's Prelims last weekend, we cast a bunch of Anyfin Paladin games where people picked Anyfin, at 24 to 26 life, so if they were lower, then their opponent would have seen 10 mana and gone, okay, he has a third anything now, but otherwise it's, oh, it's Consecration, it's Avenging Wrath. There's a lot. I really, really like Ivory Knight as a card. I think it's like there's a lot of considerations to it. Like there's a big number of decisions built into one card when you just play it. I really think it's like very deep card design, the kind of card that I wish there was a lot more of in the game, honestly, as opposed to just minions that you plop on the board and say go, right?
So. Yeah, definitely. I mean, I can definitely hear what you're saying. So what you're saying is if you play the Ivory Knight and you heal yourself for 10, then it's definitely an anything.
Yes.
But if you play the Ivory Knight and you only heal for 3, but because you could only heal for 3, then it's anything.
Ahaha! Very good. It's
probably already pretty late, right?
Yeah. That's good. No, this is what it takes to be a caster life coach. You got to get your pun game on point, and you're getting there. You'll be catching Nimsh up in no time. Don't worry about it.
Oh, okay.
So Infested Tauren onto the board, starting to get a few Death Rattles into the Bank of Nazoth, as Raven was calling it earlier. But this Pyromancer number 2 is going to make pretty quick work of this board, especially with the second Battle Rage in hand. He's able to... Does he have a Blood to Ica? He does. So he can potentially get a 3-card Battle Rage off this turn if he'd like to.
Yeah, sounds good to me.
Looks like he's just going to go for the 2 here. I guess there are overdraw concerns that he has to think about, and also utilities like Blood to Ica and like Inner Rage that he might be tempted to use this turn. They're also just like patron combo tools, let's not forget, so he needs to make sure that he breaks up his resources adequately to be able to make sure to save enough for patrons.
Yeah, but I like this. I mean, you also deal the damage, so why not?
Sure.
And then you can also clear. Okay.
Yep.
So even opting not to play it.
Yeah, I think the Battle Rage just gave him overdraw concerns that turn, right?
Sure.
As right now, he has 7 cards in hand, so he would spend 1 and draw 3. So actually, he'd go up to 9, but he wouldn't end up clearing the board, would it? No, there was still 2.
No, he could have played it instead of the Ghoul.
Right. Ah, that's right. That's right. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so I mean, it's... I can see that he will probably become stuck with this Battle Rage in his hand now and will be very sad that he didn't take the cards, I guess. But
yeah, it's possible. You know, it might have been the situation where, you know, he would have had to drop an Inner Rage or a Whirlwind at the end of his turn, and those are tools that he wants to keep in his hand for the patrons. So
right.
I can understand the thinking, but yeah, getting a Battle Rage stuck in your hand is always a bad feeling as a combo warrior when you end up just having to cast it for 1 like late in the game. It's like, oh, this could have been 4 cards 3 turns ago. What was I doing?
No, I mean, casting it for 1 would have not even been my biggest concern, but I guess my biggest concern is that you cast it for 0 in the future.
Sure.
So,
it's a Refreshment Vendor is the card that's picked up off the Light in the Darkness. Chooses to play the Pyromancer, which is his only equality activator at the moment. Just chooses just to drop it on the board just to take out 1 minion with the spell activation.
Mm-hmm.
It's a little bit dangerous with that equality sat in his hand. RDU is going to respond immediately with the Patron board. Of course, he will be able to take out the Pyromancer this turn, so Fire's going to need an additional answer here. His hand right now is just not good enough to deal with a board of Patrons.
What would that be? Consecration? I mean, Consecration would be super mega good.
Yeah.
Ideal, because you can just pair it with a Blood Mage and then it's insane.
Yes. If he picks up the second Pyromancer, then the equality is fine, but there's always the consideration as well about whether he wants to equality, even if he doesn't pick up an activator, just to neutralize the patrons at 3-1. So he will have options on this following turn, regardless of what he picks up. This is a big draw for Fire now.
Oh. Okay, that seems to be reasonable.
Does means he's going to get a 0 mana Solemn Vigil this turn as well, which is no small deal in itself.
Oh, but he opts in to do it differently, so he opts in to do a quality Pyro Solemn Vigil, right?
Yep. And as Raven and Lorinda said when they were watching the game in the previous series, where he made this exact mistake, they said, you know, you only do this once. Like once you know, and you stop doing it. Because in the previous series, he did just do Pyro Equality and then played a Forbidden Healing afterwards, just lost his Pyro for no reason.
But I'm not even sure whether you would have not done it the other way around in this case. Because you can then play Solemn Vigil for 0. still has 5 mana left, so I would prefer to have 5 mana instead of a 3-1 Pyro. But I guess he just doesn't want to do it twice in his life, so...
Yeah, I mean, with that previous game in the back of your mind, right, is like, okay, I'm willing to make the opposite mistake and have people tell me that this was wrong. I'm just like, just don't make the same mistake twice.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Has picked up Rag now, so he does have some proactive threats of his own. He's definitely been purely on the control side of this game so far, as you can tell from the, you know, the 36 health on the Warrior side. He's been under no pressure at any point, but Fire does have to set himself up a win condition at the moment because his hand is running out of control cards. He's just kind of down to threats now and needs to find some way to build up some board presence of his own.
We also have to say that Fire being at 27, I mean, in this matchup, the Warrior should pressure in order to win, and him being at 27 just shows that Warrior just couldn't accomplish that amount of pressure which would have been necessary to maybe get superior board presence.
Sure. But that is a pretty impressive board presence from RDU. Again, the power of the Arcane Giants just allowing you to do so much in a single turn here. Fire does have the potential answer with the Sylvanas. The Humility pickup is a big deal as well in terms of just immediately relieving some of the pressure from the 8-8.
Yeah, and you can probably just follow up with Thanos too, because they will probably come back. Which Death Rattle minions already died?
Infested Tauren has died,
okay.
And I believe that's it. So yeah, still Kane in hand, Blood Mage in hand. I think we've only seen a Tauren. I don't think he plays any of like the low curve threats, like Loot Hoarders and such.
Okay, yeah. Sure. But he could opt in for the Blood Mage and the Sylvanas, where, and Humility, of course, with a game plan of just playing Nezzard even next turn for Sylvanas, Blood Mage, and the Tauren. I mean, that sounds like okay-ish value to me.
Yeah, as long as you have a taunt, right, that gives you some security at least. Well, I think the big reason that Tauren is even in this deck is it's kind of just a low-quality, mediocre card overall, Infested Tauren, but most of the time in Hearthstone, you can't afford to play a 10-mana card that doesn't affect the board, right?
Yeah.
Like, taunt affects the board in a sense. If you were just to play 10-mana card that filled up with Kens and Sylvanas's, you would die immediately afterwards a lot of the time. So.
Right.
If you can't get Tyrion, which is the dream world, you're not going to draw Tyrion before you have to Nazoth every game, then Infested Tauren is like the fallback plan to give yourself some security. So patron number 2 picked up, and he has just seen that this board stuck and didn't eat an equality, so he might be feeling that there is no second equality in hand here. But the Sylvanas problem needs to be dealt with.
Yeah, and it's kind of a big problem.
It is. So just going to send everything face for now, load up the War Axe, and he's just decided it's aggression time. He looks like he's on the Grom plan now.
Well, a hybrid plan or...
Right. So with Grom and Slam in hand, he can push another 13, even if he loses his entire board on the following turn. So he's just going to say, this Sylvanas is not good enough to answer the state of my board right now. And Lay on Hands from Fire, again, that mystery card that wasn't revealed because it didn't heal him for the full 8, is going to put a slight wrench in RDU's plans right now. But unless something spectacular is picked up, he's still in a lot of trouble because the board state is going to remain.
Well, I mean, 1, 2, 4, 6, 8, 9. I mean, there is a Consecration which is doing the job. Mm-hmm. There are, as a matter of fact, there are still 2 Consecration which are doing the job, right?
Yep.
And 1 Equality. And so that makes... Oh, well, Equality is no good. No, never mind.
Yeah, and just, I mean, there's 7 damage on the board, plus another 3 from the Axe and 10 from Grom, so...
Sure, it's a lot.
He's almost there. If he can just find, like, one more turn of sticking this board, then he's probably going to be able to push through the damage, but that Lay on Hands has meant that now Ragnaros Lightlord has been picked up as well. There's a Forbidden Healing already in hand, so feels like RDU might just miss his window here for pushing through this game.
Yeah, I definitely agree there, especially because we just saw hovering over the cards that Radu only contains, that Radu's deck only contains 1 card left. So he's really out of resources here and out of gas. So if this doesn't do it, nothing does it.
Yeah, and what is the second card? Is the second card the second Arcane Giant? I think we've only seen one so far, right?
Right, yeah. It has to be.
Okay.
It has to be.
So in that case, he does have to just try and push this board as far as he can, maybe eat the second equality, and then maybe the last 8-8 sticks and can win him the game. And it's a tenuous plan at best, but it seems to be like what RDU has at this point.
You could have maybe, probably not. But you could have also tried to draw the giant, but then you don't have an activation for Gorm. So.
Yeah, exactly. He's going to draw that card next turn anyway, so I think it's not overly important to rush through that 8 damage right now, or you know, make sure that essentially give the giant charge for the next turn, right?
Yep.
By having it on the board. So Fire calculating all his outs right now, so he has all the options here. He can just you know, straight up choose to heal for 14 with Forbidden Ritual. He can choose to address the board with True Silver first. He can has a decision of whether he wants to Blood Mage as well or not Blood Mage to try and cycle an extra card. Like, all of these things consider, and he knows he only has to beat what he sees in front of him plus 4 more cards.
Yeah.
And if he's been paying perfect attention, he can probably have a good guess at what those 4 cards are. So this is one of those solvable board states in Hearthstone where you can actually work out the perfect route that always wins.
That's right. And he can even, doing what he probably goes now now with True Silver and Forbidden Healing.
Mm-hmm.
That's basically the same what you suggested, but it's just also killing a minion in
yep.
the process, so that's pretty damn good.
Exactly. And the last...
And we were...
Oh,
no.
We missed an Arcane Giant life coach.
This one, damn.
So that is a huge difference. The fact there's like one less 8-8 than we were planning for. So at 27, there is 9 damage, 19 damage, plus the second Fiery War Axe is 25 if everything only gets to attack once. But still, no perfect board clear in hand for Fire. So the game is not 100% over just yet, but it's getting there.
Mm. So what has happened? 6, 7, 8, 9 now? And every turn he... Okay, he receives 10 life back, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what does he do against Grommash? I mean, he doesn't even... I mean, he needs to shrink it?
Yeah, he has Keeper of Alderman right now, which is his best option.
But it's not... I mean, he doesn't have access to heal. It's actually pretty close, I
think. It is, yeah. If Fire is going to need to something out of his deck here, which is why I brought up playing the Blood Mage to heal for 4 less, essentially, as a
powerful
option
on
the previous turn. Because he knows that he does need to dig and find out a final answer.
Oh, but it would have not changed, because the Patron would have dealt 3. So... He got rid of 1 patron, and that what was the patron was dealing 3. So
sure, yeah, makes sense. So this is it, all or nothing for Fire here, and he
Fire
does
is?
Not look
happy.
Barnes.
That's very very rough. Any consecration which would have done it.
It would, yeah. But now, even Solemn Vigil, pick up Consecrate isn't good enough. That'll leave the Grom around, so you'll just die, so...
Exactly.
Yeah.
And Consecration would have just cleared the entire board. That's so insane.
Yep.
So what do? You can shrink the Grom, so that means 9, 10, 11, 12, 15 on the board. It's just not good enough.
Solemn
Vigil.
Not seeing
for
a line. Light Lord isn't good enough. Fire Lord isn't good enough, even if it hits the Grom. I don't see it. I think the game's over.
He tries to discount it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's clever. I like it. Mm. So Consecration is being picked up, but
it's just not good enough.
Just not good enough.
Doesn't have the mana to neutralize the Grom as well. Would have needed to Keeper it and Consecrate the board to be able to survive there, or have another Equality clear, some sort of Humility effect, those kind of things. So didn't quite get it done, and RDU just kind of squeaked over the line there in what seemed like a very unfavorable matchup for large periods.
Until the very end.
Yeah.
And at the very end, I mean, I can understand Fire's frustration, because it really looked insanely good for him. He only needed to draw one of all of these pieces and he would have been completely fine. He already knew RDU out of cards in his deck, only keeping one card in his hand. He only needs to deal with one minion and maybe heal himself a little tiny bit, and then he's just out of the woods, but it just didn't happen.
Certainly not. And now it's going to come down to the Yogg Druid versus the Combo Warrior. Arcane Giants on both sides, so it's week 2 Karazhan cards. And this is the deck that put in work for Fire during the Swiss portion. I think he said he 3-0'd 3 or 4 series with this deck in the Swiss proceedings. So He's a big fan of this deck. It's got him this far, but now it's going to have to win two more games for him. He's going to have to 2-0 from here with the Yogdruid to come out of this series.
No, which is definitely possible.
Oh, it's, I mean, if I had to fall back on one deck in Hearthstone these days, I think, you know, Token Druid in some form, you know, be it, you know, Yogg, no Yogg, Maligos, like something like that. The shell of the deck in some form is one of the most powerful things in the game, for sure.
Exactly.
Yeah, Raven Idol going to come out here on turn one. Already has the Wild Growth in hand. So where do you stand on this Raven Idol debate? Because I've heard some people look at hands like this and say, I mean, I already have the Wild Growth, which is what I want to do on turn two, right? So I don't Raven Idol on turn one. I Wild Growth on turn two. And then my Raven Idol is flexible later to go with the Violet Teacher that's in my hand, with a Fandral if I draw it. Yep. Whereas if you don't have the ramp in your hand, sure, go ahead and cast the turn one Raven Idol, because then you can get the ramp. So have you ever found yourself like deliberately holding on to a turn one Raven Idol to cast later on?
If you have Fandral in the hand, for sure.
Okay.
If you don't, I usually don't.
Okay, so you don't think Violet Teacher is good enough synergy to justify interrupting the mana curve with it, I guess?
No, because you pay and one extra mana for it, and for that you get one extra 1/1 delivered. But it's not one mana for 1/1, because it's one mana for 1/1 once you already have the teacher up, and usually you can, if you already have to, if you already paid these four mana for the teacher, you can probably also do other stuff in a better way.
Sure. Sense. Teacher is going to come down here. No Innovate from Fire, though. Nothing to spend the mana on with the Innovate. And we'll see exactly how RDU chooses to address this. He has pretty much all the options in the world to kill a 3-5 with that Fiery War Axe right now. He can Ichor it and then coin a Ravaging Ghoul. He can use the Pyromancer. He can just straight up execute it. Or you can just chill and kill it over two turns, safe in the knowledge that if a bunch of 1-1s come out, your deck has like 15 different whirlwinds in it that can deal with them.
Right.
No big deal. Fire choosing to nourish for the cards here. Probably the good decision based on the makeup of his hand. Didn't really have anything to ramp into here. He's now picked up a lot more individual threats.
I really like it, drawing cards, and I also really like that you produce exactly 1-1-1, because that's the most nastiest. If you produce 1-1-1, he probably also still needs to play the Ghoul. So 1 equals 3, or 4 or more.
Yeah, makes sense. Violet Teacher number 2 picked up, which, you know, in this matchup, Violet Teacher is probably not the powerhouses that they are in a lot of matchups. You really are going to need to combine it with that Power of the Wild if you want to get any sort of value in it, but even a board full of 2/2s, right? The deck has so many whirlwinds in it that 2/2s are just going to go bye-bye just as easily as 1/1s are most of the time.
By the way, did you like it? I would have liked Azure Dragon to Living Roots on the 3/3.
Drake Roots on, what I was looking at straight away, for sure. The Starfire did seem like a strange decision. I'm not sure, like, long-term, he might be mentally just a little bit too defensive against the patrons in his mind. So Drake plus Swipe is a great tool. Drake plus Roots is a great tool. All of these things for killing 3/3 patrons. But,
makes sense.
Yeah, so I can understand it, especially, you know, for a kid on the stage for the first time in the last game. The tendency, and it's wrong, it's absolutely wrong to just like say play as safe as possible, because you delude yourself into the wrong thing. You call the wrong thing safe when you go down that line.
Exactly.
But I can understand why you would have that mentality in this situation as Fire. Because as with most combo decks, you can hold back all the answers that you want, but if you don't pressure them and you just give them time to do it, bad things are going to happen to you eventually.
Yeah, definitely agree here. I mean, the dragon, I mean, it seems very nice. He draws your card, he cycles your card, he gives you spell power to deliver the exact 3 damage on the ghoul. It's also a tempo play. On the other hand, we have Starfire, which is not a tempo play, which draws you another one of those cards you don't need, and you just overkill the ghoul by 2 damage, which is kind of huge.
Right.
I mean, he could have simply Starfire the Emperor Saurus next turn. That's, of course, in hindsight, but there are better targets.
Yeah, Acolyte now has cycled some cards nicely for RDU, but Fire, again, plenty of initiative left in his hand. Does have his choice of minions with Fandral, Azure Drake, Ancient of War, and again, it looks like I mean, this, it has to be the, like, his mentality has to be that those Drake and Living Roots go together, right? That's the only explanation.
Definitely agree. I would have to be honest, thought that Fender and Wrath and Living Roots go together, so maybe even playing something else and then playing this insane Fender turn, but yeah, it didn't happen.
Yeah, I agree. I think Fire is just playing this game a little bit too passively right now, just too scared of the patrons coming out. This is, honestly, this quite often it's a deck where the patrons are used as a tool to progress through the game.
Yep.
Like, they're not necessarily just a huge win condition. It's like, sometimes I'm just going to use my patrons to Battle Rage for five cards so that I can get all the way through my deck. You know, it's not, they're not necessarily the things that win the game immediately like they used to be back in the old days.
Yep.
So I think being scared to the point of, like, you know, I'm going to make weaker plays to make sure I can kill patrons is just a little bit scared.
I also have to say that, I mean, double Living Grids might not even be enough against patrons, right?
Right. You kill two of them. Like, what if there's six?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, you just kill two.
Yeah, but the problem has been reversed here because RDU has the issue of a Fandral on the board that he doesn't really have too nice an answer to, and he is going to play the shut my eyes and hope nothing too bad happens game against Fandral Staghelm. And
you said he shuts his eyes and plays the 10-10 and hopes nothing bad is gonna happen. I think we had this already beforehand, right? At some point of this day.
The old leave Aviana alive play, because what could possibly go wrong? 10-10 being dropped, probably, you know, it's bad for RDU because it forces his hand, but you know, there were being combinations of, you know, Living Roots and Power of the Wild that probably would have made a bigger mess than this. This can be nice and cleanly answered by just one execute that the RDU has perfect access to. So
he could even, I mean, he could even Whirlwind execute and maybe even whatever Grommon Fender if he wants. I don't know.
Yeah, it's reasonable. He has the potential to drop Arcane Giants this turn as well if he wants to, or at least the one of them. So. It's one of the great things about combo decks like this is there's always so many paths you can go down each turn, right? Especially when you're playing so many cycle cards in your deck. Like, you don't know what your full decision tree is at the start of the turn. You have to, like, start going through and work things out as you go along.
I mean, the turn Radu just found out was definitely stronger. So that was just very, very sick and insane what he just pulled off here.
Yep.
Seizing the board control, killing both of the opposing minions, drawing a bunch of cards, just very insane.
Yeah, and Ancient of War number 2 going to come down here, and now there's no executes to deal with this cleanly. So even with the Pyromancer, which will probably just be taken out with the Hero Power anyway, this is a big ask to chew through 10 points of health here.
Yeah. Definitely.
So I do wonder, there was the opportunity to develop the Arcane Giant on the previous turn. I imagine he will be a little bit scared of Mulch in this situation. But, you know, having run out of his premium removal in the form of Execute, like having an 8-8 on the board would have helped him fight in these same sorts of eventualities. You know, if there was just an Azir Drake or an Ancient War in this case that needed taking out, he would have that big minion in play to help him do it.
Right.
War is going to come out. Oh, never
mind. There we go.
Never mind. So now we have to have an Arcane Giant turn, right? It's just too good, I think.
I mean, I also have to say, with Fire keeping Yogg from the beginning of the game, I mean, Yogg is basically a counter to a full board of patrons, right?
That's true.
So he also already had the mechanics or the tools to deal with such a board.
Mm-hmm. That's a very good point. But do you see anything better this turn than just, you know, an execute activator, be it, you know, Ravaging Ghoul, whatever else you want to use, and then just drop the 8-8 here? Is he going to Grom it?
I like it very much, yeah. Oh, well, what?
Going to Grom?
Oh, yeah, okay. Interesting.
Just going to Grom it for value by the looks of things. Oh, no, he is going to use the execute.
Yeah.
Push through. Okay, fair enough.
I don't mind it. That's also very good.
Fire pumping his fist here, picks up the mulch. You can see why he was so happy there immediately. I was like, it looked like he was celebrating getting Grommed in the face from our perspective for a second. Then the mulch appeared and everything became crystal clear. Siddiq Swamp.
Siddiq Swamp. Not doing that much against Druid.
Probably not, no. And with Grom gone now, RDU has to find himself a win condition, but two Arcane Giants is a pretty solid one, but now RDU kind of has that tug-of-war situation, right? It's like, do I wait for a Yogg before I make this push? Do I push and hope he doesn't have it? Do I push and hope his Yogg isn't that good when it comes out? So this is some of the things you do have to consider when you're playing against a Yogg deck. It's just slightly unfortunate at the end of the day it comes down to, well, I'm just going to cross my fingers and pray.
sure. I mean, the double Arcane Giant here is definitely very vulnerable to Yogg, but yeah, probably he goes for it because one Arcane Giant is just not enough.
Yeah.
I mean, with one Arcane Giant is doing nothing on this board.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, cross the fingers. Okay.
Interesting.
So, okay.
Four damage living roots, sorry. Potential for a five damage living roots with the Blood Mage, but one of the 8/8s is staying up this turn, right?
Yeah. So. I mean, you're in danger.
With Grom gone, though, he saw basically every card in the deck in the previous game that went to Fatigue. So with Grom gone, he knows there's actually no charge damage to play around. He didn't see charge, he didn't see faceless, any of that stuff. Yeah. So he actually knows he's relatively safe in this situation. And it looks like he's trying to be as greedy as possible with his Yogg here, because remember, he also knows he hasn't seen any patrons yet this game. So.
Yeah, exactly. I guess it's what you basically also described earlier. I guess Fire wants to have the answer once the patrons go down on the board.
And those patrons are coming down right now. So it looks like RDU has decided he can't hang around too much longer if he does commit to this patron line. Again, same sort of thing I spoke about before. He won't feel terrible because he can cycle at the same time. And it's one of the great things about Patron Warrior is that you quite often make this huge push and develop a bunch of threats, but at the same time you just replace all those cards in your hand as you do it. So
Warrix is another 6, so if he plays Warrix it's already 16.
Mm-hmm.
So basically forcing the shapeshift, which is also pretty good.
Yep.
Okay, he goes for the killing the dragon, which is also perfectly fine.
I'm just gonna drop the ooze alongside it, just trying to generate pressure wherever he can right now. This game is coming right down to the wire, but the defensive lines are running out here from Fire.
Yeah.
How brave are you in this situation? Because I think now you've seen every source of direct damage from hand, right?
Yeah.
So you are actually alive at 7, in theory.
Yeah, you're alive. You play the Nourish. I mean, you don't play the Yogg now, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, that would be so inconsistent.
Are you that brave? Because remember, there was 3 or 4 cards sight unseen that he didn't see, right? That could have been anything.
All right.
That were
all
still in hand. So I'm sure he has guessed the rest of the list based on what he knows from the meta. He's like, okay, he's playing that version of the deck that has no charge in it. But
there was only one card. There was only one card he didn't play.
Was there only one?
Yeah, he only had one card left in his hand.
Fair enough.
So I guess there's not that much room.
All right, sure. In that case, I mean, he does end up nourishing and it makes perfect sense in that situation. So. Yeah, putting your opponent here on just needing one damage, and back in the days of Patron Warrior having things like Corcron Elite in their deck and all this thing, you'd never ever make this play.
Never ever.
This is a much more all-in deck.
The swipe was also interesting because it's basically what you described. I mean, Fire had the decision to maybe even maintain the swipe in the hand to Blood Mage into swipe,
right?
Staying alive at 1 life, but I guess it's that doesn't feel very good.
Nope. So here we go, patron board number 1. He's picked up the resources he needs to make a second patron board as well on the following turn. So it looks like this is going to be the moment. The Yogg that Fire has been holding the entire game picks up the Innovate as well, so he can add an extra spell in there.
Three
extra spells, in fact, right, because of the wild growth. So,
Radar's already down to 1 card, so what's your guess this time? Because I have no clue.
I don't know. I got burned last time, so I'm just going to wait and see what it is. And patrons, not the
More
easiest
patrons.
Things to clear in the world. You need a clean Snake answer, or you need to fill the board first. So
here we get that. Here's so many spells. Pyroblast on. Ooh. Oh, Sinister Strike. Mining is all sick. Yeah, it's good. It's good. It's good. What?
All right. Well, it's not a minion, because that is a shadow of nothing. That's what happens when you mind blaster. Sorry, mind game's an empty deck.
I've never.
There you go. Learning things today, life coach.
Oh, I've never seen this.
Oh!
There it is. Bam. Anything. Boom.
Oh my god. Oh my god. Is that a wrong target?
Please. Whoa. Okay.
It's alive! It got to attack! Wow.
Wow.
Okay then.
Oh wow. This is so sick.
All the good hunter traps as well.
This is so sick. Speaking of RNG.
Yeah.
Like, this is just crazy.
And we, on the back of Yogg-Saron, Hope's End, are going to a game five here. I don't see a way out, right? Bloodmage Swipe can follow this up and take care of another patron board.
It's just silly, yeah.
Yeah. This is just game. RDU looks like he's on the verge of tears from that Yogg-Saron at the top.
He wouldn't be the first.
That's very true. It's just such a nightmare to navigate as a player when, you know, there's a bunch of secrets in play that have been played by Yogg.
Yeah.
You can't even rule out the nonsense, like misdirect and eye for an eye and all this crap that comes from a bunch of different classes. So you literally have to try and play around everything, and that's just maddening to try and do. You know, it could have been Snipe for all he knew.
Yeah,
Catrick as well could have come out. Of course, that is available in the new wing. So even though he couldn't put it in his deck, he could have got it from the random effect.
He cannot even hero power because there might be that trap.
Yep,
Poison Nose.
Yep. Yes. And just pushing through. The power of the wild is lethal here. And RDU, after so much work in that game, his hopes were ended by Yogg-Saron, and he's going to have to do it all over again in game five now.
Did you, by the way, just saw the uprooted tree? There was the freaking uprooted tree. It was 10-5. it was a sapling of war. Did you see it?
Wow.
10-5 sapling. Yogg-Saron, holy crap.
Yogg-Saron makes everything possible, even uprooting, apparently. Look at that face.
Oh, man. Rado is like, what the... this is too sick.
Yeah.
This is too sick to be true. Oh, wow. Fire is also... I think both players are really at the edge of their nerves.
Is Fire balding at 17 years old? There seems to be some definite thinning of the hair at the top there.
Say that?
I was curious. I'll ask him afterwards, it's fine. All right, so the good old Yogg Druid mirror. Both players with a big old pile of ramp in their opening hand.
Wow. I mean, this is so intense because both players, it's the decider. It's two against two, and it goes back and forth and back and forth. Two games straight up to fatigue, both being decided with the very, very last card or cards. It's just an insane match here.
Yeah. Absolutely is, and looks like this game is going to be no short of fireworks either, because both players have pretty promising looking opening hands here. RDU holds on to both Innovates and the Nourish. Okay, RDU's hand is just 100% mana, 0% things to spend it on.
I mean, Fire Ascent is, well...
Yeah.
I mean...
Wow, it's a swipe!
I mean, it's very similar.
Yeah. This is going to get very, very weird very quickly.
Oh, yes. With the Arcane Giant, definitely.
Wait, so Arcane Giant...
Rado will probably simply draw the cards, I guess. I cannot imagine him ramping anywhere.
With the second Innovate in hand already as well, yeah. The card draw just means that he'll probably be able to play, you know, a decent threat that he draws.
Oh, wow.
The Innovate.
Oh, wow.
Oh.
Three react... Are you kidding me? Three reactives. That's so unlikely and so unlucky.
It really is, yeah. And Fire... So Fire Wild Growths again here. The Arcane Giant goes down to 10, and he has an Innovate, which can take it down to 9, but he'll be on 6 mana, so it doesn't quite work just yet.
Yeah. I mean, you also have to point out that the luck distribution goes for both players. I mean, Fire just drawing 2 swipes.
Yeah.
It's really not much better, so...
Hey, that's a little bit more promising. There's something we can play on 5 mana next turn. It's Druid is such nonsense. It's like, hey, I drew a 7-mana card. This is great. I can play that on my 5-mana turn, which is turn 3 of the game. Yeah, yeah. Next turn. Like, what? Play by the rules, Druid. Come on.
Oh, really?
Double just going to drop the double Living Roots hit? Wow.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
We just thought that Fire wouldn't have a nice next turn, but it just changed.
Now his hand works. I mean, swipe into Arcane Giant if he doesn't pick anything up over the next two turns.
Yeah, that's awesome.
It actually ties his hand together. Raven Idol was a big deal as well here. Do you ever pick a minion? Just based on the way this game's been going and everyone filling up their hand with spells, do you ever pick a minion?
No, I would definitely take a spell. No. You can take a Nourish or a Mage, but I would just go for the Nourish here for sure, right?
Nourish seems good for sure, yeah.
Your hand is empty, you have to pick the Nourish. And bam, swipe. In the face.
Yep. So that is now an 8-mana Arcane Giant, which means that Innovate is actually weirdly useless next turn if he wants to play it. He would innovate his 8-mana Giant down to 7-mana. Yeah.
He can shapeshift.
That's true, yeah.
But I would assume that Nourish goes down for sure.
Yeah. Well, I mean, now that there's a 5-10 on the board, he might feel like he wants an 8-8 to contest it, but at the same time, digging through to Mulch makes a lot of sense as well, so... Yeah, just going to go ahead, snaps the Nourish, cycles through, Blood Mage being picked up. We haven't really talked about the Blood Mage in this list. I know it's kind of a fringe inclusion. I don't think Radu is playing it in his list from what I've seen. So I think I've seen you play with Blood Mage in tournament games before. Is that right?
Yes. Tyson and me, we decided on running one Blood Mage in the list we played at that point.
So what's the benefit of it? You're just trying to pair like Blood Mage Swipe together more commonly, and like what's that good against specifically?
Yeah, it's better against Zoo because you can play Blood Mage Swipe on turn 6 or turn 7, and that's usually sealing the deal against Zoo if you can make a good swipe happen.
Right. So again, if you're against an aggro deck, like Drake Swipe is often game winning, but most of the time you need Innovate to go with it as well for it to like really be backbreaking. So Blood Mage just kind of does the same thing a lot cheaper.
Exactly.
All right, so finally this Arcane Giant that Fire has been toying around with for the first few turns is able to come down onto the board here, but he has just drawn his own Ancient of War, which, you know, what better to contest a 5-10 with than the 5-10 of your own? Or, if you're feeling extra ambitious, a 10-5.
No, I really like the Ancient of War here. I see literally no reason to go for the Giant. Why should you? I mean, the Shapeshift goes into nowhere. And the Arcane Giant will become cheaper. And we are not talking about a little bit cheaper. We are talking about the Arcane Giant becoming like probably 2 or 3 mana. Not cheaper, like literally 2 or 3 mana at some point.
I agree with you. I think if the swipe wasn't in hand, I could see this line because, you know, your 8 plus a Living Roots deals with the 10, right? Yep. But it's exactly the same way. Your 5 plus a Blood Mage swipe deals with the 10 just the same way. So I kind of agree with you. I don't see any reason why we'd play the card that's just working its way down to 0 mana in our hand right now. So the decision in Handlock is like, do I play this 5 mana Mountain Giant or this 5 mana Molten Giant? So I'm going to play the Mountain Giant because the Molten Giant's going to get cheaper.
Cheaper, yeah. Mm-hmm. Nowadays, the Molten Giant will...
But nowadays, if you have a 5-mana Molten Giant, you're pretty dead. So now the Ancient of War is going to come down. Eaten the first Mulch from RDU already. We'll feel pretty confident. I mean, this may have already been a consideration as well. It's just like, I value this 5-10 taunt more. Yep. So I'm going to check for Mulch with my 8-8. That may have been his thinking, but... As we can see, RDU is choosing to go with the double Mulch list and actually has both of them in his hand. So he is going to be able to chew through the first two huge threats, but there is a second Ancient of War coming as well now.
He could have also cleared with Blood Mage Swipe double Roots. But
that's true. Yeah. That's very true, actually. I didn't think about that.
That one's good, I think. Let's see. He can play Blood Mage Swipe. Oh, okay. He just goes for there. This dude again.
Blood Mage Swipe Living Roots would be 8 on the 5-10, which means Dreadscale wouldn't quite finish it off.
Yeah, that's a problem.
Yeah, so I don't think it's quite there. But he is going to use the Blood Mage Living Roots just to take out the 3-3, just to create some more tension on the board. Otherwise, his 10 health just goes down immediately.
Well, the definitely is a lot of tension here in this very final game. I'm really so excited about this series. It's really crazy, back and forth, all the time. Yeah.
Yeah, and it's been accentuated as well by them being two obviously very emotional players, right? They've been wearing their hearts on their sleeves. You know, most people who go through a series like this will feel like this, but you know, you see people like Oskaka, for example, keep it all very bottled up the whole time. That doesn't mean he's not feeling it. It's just it's not his style to let it all out on the camera like that. But these two guys have just been, you know, letting their facial expressions and body movements and everything tell the story for them.
Whereas I saw some Oskaka movement when he missed this lethal.
That's very true.
I think it's the first time I see him upset probably the entire Hearthstone career.
That was a very eventful series, to say the least. But this series, no slouch of its own. It's coming down to the crucial moments right now. RDU just going to generate Foundrel on the board just as an additional threat. Make sure that he has enough superiority on the board to see him through here. But
whoa, this Blood Mage is doing some serious
work.
It
really is, yeah.
That's really big. Can he even do something with the Wrath for 2 and Threat Scale? I think he can swipe the tree.
Tree, cycle Wrath on Foundrel, and then Dread Scale, yeah.
He doesn't even need Dread Scale, right? He can just send the Blood Mage too.
Sure, yeah, that works too. Yeah. Right, because the Blood Mage dies either way, so...
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. So probably starting off with Wrath on the tree, right? No, wait.
Wrath the Foundrel, right?
Wrath the Foundrel, he's at
2, and then you swipe the tree. Foundrel goes down to 1, trade in the Blood Mage.
Yep.
Ooh. Hey, Violet Teacher.
Not too
bad.
That
works nicely.
That works pretty nicely.
That is a huge turn now for Fire. And honestly, if you take Yogg out the equation, which we can't this game because both players have drawn it, but if it doesn't come down to being a Yogg game, the winner of this matchup is usually the first person to just make a board that looks like this, right? Because it's so much tempo to come back. And like RDU immediately recognizes, I have no way to beat this except for Yogg. The Healing Touch goes the wrong way. Frost Nova's fine, but it's not going to be good enough. He needs to actually
suffer
the board.
For 2 or what? Tiny Fin.
Yogg, you monster.
Whoa. Okay, Bolster doesn't do anything. Savage Tree doesn't do anything.
Nope.
Pyro, what? Whoa! Okay.
All right.
Okay. Oh, conceal, what? Okay. That's pretty good, right?
I think if every Yogg I ever saw was narrated by Life Coach, I'd feel a lot better about the card, honestly.
Wow.
I mean, there's a 7-10 that might just kill you next turn on the board. That's quite scary.
But Fire likes the gamble. You remember the other game where he stayed on 1 life, 3 life, 4 life? So
yes, very true.
It seems that, he likes it. He likes the gamble. So, and it works out for him very well here, very nicely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it gets a pretty impressive board out of this, and Yogg has already been used because it's on the board, so...
Whoa, for
not quite. So Swipe is lethal?
Yeah. Swipe is lethal. Swipe is dead.
No, he doesn't have mana for hero power as well. He would need to hero power as well, right?
True.
Yeah,
true,
so that. Swipe would actually be 1 mana off.
Yep.
Savage Roar? The taunt has 3 health? 4 health. Okay, so Savage Roar plus hero power doesn't get through the taunt.
Yep.
Yeah, taunt has 4 health. Awkward.
Might would be basically also 2 of lethal. So super close. It's super, super exciting and amazing game. It's really crazy. It's really so crazy.
Coming right down to the wire here, and there is merit to all of these picks, honestly, in this situation. RDU knows that his tournament life is riding on the line here. It probably comes down very much to what he picks, and he's going to just choose to mulch for value to take out the Azure Drake. Use the Feral Rage to push through, still gets to push 7 to face and develop an 8-8 at the same time. I like this line in the end. It was a good balanced play between respecting the board and still setting himself up with lethal draws the next turn.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah, I really like it too.
Moat Lurker! Moat Lurker of all things!
You're kidding me here.
I am not kidding. That is a card right there. That is an assassinate with a body. Wow. Moat Lurker mulch means that that we are setting up just lethal on board for Fire, right? If he gets to push through all this damage to face and generates the extra 3-3 on board, this is just setting up lethal.
Setting up lethal for Radu with a King Crush coming out.
Okay. I mean, something crazy has to happen again. This game, bro!
What? Come on. What?
Can that actually do anything, though?
I'm not sure.
In this deck, there really aren't that many high-value Barnes targets.
No.
That's one of the better ones, believe it or not, and it's just not going to do anything.
No.
And that means...
So close.
11 damage on board, plus the hero power. Fire is going to top 8 of Insomnia. Although, what is the secret, actually? Is the secret
snake
relevant?
Trap.
Secret snake trap? Okay.
I mean, I'm guessing.
Okay. Awesome. So yeah, incredible series in the end. Fire, everything you could possibly wish would happen that series did. We had crazy Yogg outcomes, games going down to fatigue, and yeah, I guess Fire completes the tilt in the end and gets the back-to-back victories over RDU to book a spot in top 8.
I think like I can't even add anything on top of that, of what you have discussed during the games. First of all, they were super long.
Yeah.
It took a while to finish even one game from the entire match. Almost everything was coming to the wire, as you said. Fatigue games, crazy Yoggs. I feel like both players were kind of annoyed by how the games were decided.
Sure.
Right? But in the end, it was a very exciting match.
And I think, honestly, you can understand disappointment. You know, I had this experience at HCT where I interviewed a player and he got this crazy six spell Yogg that won in the game, and I asked him about it and he said, you know, I didn't want to win like that. You know, it felt unfair. And it makes sense, because when you play a competitive game, right, it's to battle your wits against someone else's. That's what you want to do. And Yogg takes away from that to an extent, but let's not make what we watched entirely about Yogg. There was a whole level of crazy play there going on.
Like,
there was a lot of, you know, decision making and high level Hearthstone from both of those players involved.